Welcome to the Radical Lifestyle Podcast, brought to you by Generation to Generation, where you will be inspired by the past, equipped for the present, and prepared for the future as we engage in conversations with people from around the world. Hello everyone, this is Andrew and Daphne from Generation to Generation, and our guest today is Ronnie Stevens. Ronnie, for people that don't know who you are, can you just say a bit about where you're from and what you do?
Well, I'm from Atlanta, Georgia. I now live in a suburb of Memphis, Tennessee called Germantown. I'm a retired pastor and missionary. I'm actually wrestling right now with a job offer, which would make me an associate pastor again. I hope to have an answer by the weekend. And I have pastored churches in America on the North Carolina coast and in Memphis, but also in Munich, Germany, and Moscow, Russia, and Budapest, Hungary. And my motivation to go to Munich was to work behind the Iron Curtain covertly. I went there in 1986, and the wall fell in 89, and the Soviet Union imploded in November of 91, and in the summer of 92, we moved into Russia. And my wife has a winter darkness syndrome, and the Moscow winters really, really took her down in a dangerous way. So we came back to Memphis for 9 years, but then we went back overseas in 2003. And for 13 years, I was pastor of the Danube International Church in Budapest. And then handing that off at age 65, we went back to Russia for almost 4 years. So we've been in Memphis since November of 2019. I'm 70 years old, but I preach about every other Sunday in a small church in Mississippi as a volunteer, and I'm thinking about taking up a full-time job in a larger church in Memphis, but I'm just waiting on the Lord to show us about that. So,
and I know we've heard you teach a few times, and they've all been hugely powerful, and we've loved hearing you speak. I know you mentioned before we started recording that there's a website people could go to if they're interested in maybe some of your writings and things like that. They may be able to find some audios and things there. Where can they go to that website? Where is that?
Rampartpublications.com.
Okay, and we'll put that link in the description box. So for people listening, it's there for you, ready to go and check out.
Thank you.
So, Ronnie, where did all this start? I mean, you know, you've obviously got a heart for people, you've got a heart for the gospel, you've got a heart for the Lord, which has taken you across the nations. When you look back, was there a pivotal moment, or is it just a gradual thing that your life headed in this direction?
Well, it's a little bit complicated. It's also a little bit embarrassing because I grew up a godly mother. Now, my dad was a professing Christian. He was actually a Baptist deacon. I cannot say that the things of the Lord were ever important to him in a way that was obvious to me. Other things were more important. Actually, the last day he could talk before he slipped into his final coma was the first time I got strong assurance that he knew the Lord. And I'm very, very grateful for that gift from God at the last moment to make me feel better about my father leaving this planet. My mother was very godly. My mother cared about missions. And because of that, I, for much of my life, actually to my mid-40s, I was convinced that I came to Christ as a child. I was baptized at age 9, and my original understanding was that I drifted away from the Lord in my teens, and I came back to the Lord at age 20. Upon mature reflection, by my mid-40s, I realized that, no, I didn't come back to the Lord at age 20. I actually came to the Lord for the first time at age 20. The change at age 20 was absolutely radical. I mean, I became unrecognizable from the person I was before. And the reason I thought that I was always a Christian is because I always affirmed the basic data of the gospel. I believe that Jesus was the Son of God. I believe that he died for my sins on the cross. I believe that in trusting in that, I could be saved. All the intellectual assent was always in order. But one thing that began to bear in on me to sort of wreck that narrative is I began to remember more specific sins during those years of wandering. And I'm not talking about the usual sins of the 60s. I was born in 1950, so my teen years tracked like an overlay the 60s. And we all know how famous the 60s were for riotous living in the far country, but not just those obvious things, but other things, more troubling things. And I realized that until age 20, there was no restraint before sin, and there was no regret after sin. And I kept thinking, you know, that's not the mark of a regenerate person. That's not a symptom of salvation. And so by my mid-40s, I concluded, no, you came to Christ the first time at age 20. And then the Lord did something really special. When my mom died in 2014, my wife found a letter that I wrote to my parents as an 18-year-old. And I was basically telling my dad that I could not go into the family business after university. And the reason I gave him was because I felt called to the ministry. Now, you might think, well, golly, that's proof that you really did know the Lord before age 20. But quite the contrary. When I read the letter was so painful, I still haven't read all of it. I still haven't finished it. I couldn't finish it. It was too painful because it was so full of self, all of me and none of Jesus, that it was actually a great documentation and confirmation that, no, I was not saved then. I wasn't even saved then when I thought, you know, I'm probably going to be a minister. So that's a little bit scary. And I wouldn't want to scare anyone else with that testimony. I wouldn't want to shake anyone out of their own assurance. But I would say this, if there's no restraint before sin, and if there's no regret after sin, it really doesn't matter that much how orthodox you are. You probably don't know the Lord. So that's my story.
Wow, that is a very profound statement. No regret before sin, and no restraint before sin, and no regret after sin. That should lead to many thinking. So then you came to the Lord and you had an encounter with him. What happened next in pursuing what you had already decided prior to that?
Well, what happened was I turned myself over to Campus Crusade for Christ. My senior year at university, I completely wasted the first 3 years. And I, of course, I had deep, deep regret about that. And I showed up and I said, clean me up. And they discipled me faithfully. I think I wanted, you know, there was tremendous prophetic fervor in the West at that time because of the Arab-Israeli Six-Day War in 67. And there was kind of a throbbing expectation of the Lord's soon return, which is a good thing. And I thought, you know, I'm pretty tired of school. I don't want to go on for former training. I think I would like to be, I think I'd like to go on to Campus Crusade staff and just start witnessing in the little time we have left. And probably with not the best motives, my dad encouraged me to go on to seminary. And I wanted to be submissive to him for the first time in my life. And his arguments were not the best. I think he thought there'd be more prestige with another degree and there'd be more earning power with another degree, which are two terrible reasons to go to seminary. But I did submit. And after a little while, I realized, well, I really did need more training. And I was always going to ask questions about, well, does the Bible really say this or does it mean that? And So I became a very missions-minded pastor. And then what an opportunity after 9 years in American pastorates, an opportunity came to move to Europe and to pastor a local English-speaking church, but to work covertly in five East Bloc nations, the Soviet Union, Poland, Romania, Czechoslovakia, and Hungary. And so I did that until the wall fell, and then we moved into Russia for 2 years, and then later we moved back to Russia. So ministry was, you know, I'm not one of these Renaissance people who can do a lot of things. I'd probably starve to death if I didn't preach. I suppose I could have been a football coach, but it was easy for me to decide what to do because I couldn't do anything else. But I really did have one of those 1 Corinthians 9 compulsions of woe is me if I preach not the gospel. That's always been there.
So you're behind the Iron Curtain, all those nations, I think, that you mentioned. Can you talk to us about what that was like? I mean, we have a real heart for persecuted nations, and have actually, I can remember as a child, praying for the persecuted church in Russia. So that's been a part of our DNA. Can you talk to us about your time there and what you experienced?
Well, even what, I mean, why did you decide, you know what, I want to take that place on? What?
Yeah.
You know, maybe there are probably some far easier places for you to go to.
Well, you know, because I'm attracted to need. And in the U.S., sometimes I feel like I'm watering a flooded lawn. And it's not that there are not plenty of unbelievers in the West. There are. I mean, Europe is one of the most unevangelized continents in the world when it comes to a percentage of people who we would say had a born-again experience or that we could classify as evangelicals, people who are serious about the gospel. But it's not because people in America don't know where they can get the gospel, that they don't know where they could go or what they should do to hear it. I mean, there's so much Christian radio. There's so much Christian literature. And there's so many churches. Obviously, only a certain percentage of the churches preach the gospel, but there's a decent percentage where at least you can learn how to get your sins forgiven and to know Christ personally. Whereas there's so many people, well, you take a city like Moscow. Now, of course, Russia is traditionally Christian, and I don't want to say any bad things about the Orthodox Church, because obviously there are Christians among the Orthodox just like there are lost people among Protestants like ourselves. But the gospel is pretty much in the background. The gospel is pretty much hidden by ritual and ceremony, and even I would say superstition. So to find somebody in a city of 15 million people who could define the gospel, that would be a very rare and an unlikely thing. So I'm attracted to need. And so the people in the Soviet bloc, they couldn't have a truly Bible teaching Bible school or seminary. They really weren't allowed to proclaim their faith publicly and openly, especially among people under 18 years old. There were strict laws against that. And it wasn't to go into the East Bloc before 1989, really before the early 90s, it was sort of like stumbling into a black and white movie in the 40s and not a very nice movie. I mean, everything was monochrome. There was nothing in the shops that would interest anybody from the West. There were empty shelves. There was shoddy, subpar merchandise because, you know, that economic system simply doesn't work. And that can be proved empirically. And it wasn't, the East Bloc countries were not monolithic. What I mean by that is that they weren't all the same. It was more risky, for instance, to do something to involve yourself in missionary activity in a place like Czechoslovakia or Romania than it was in a place like Poland or a place like Hungary. when you landed at Otopeni International Airport in Bucharest, for instance, there was a sign in Romanian and in English, and it said, no drugs, no pornography, and no Bibles. And that regime under Ceausescu was pretty repressive. The same was true in Czechoslovakia. In Hungary, they were so influenced by the West. Of course, they were on the edge of the West, and they pretended to be good communists just up to the threshold of keeping the Soviets off their back. You know, they called it goulash socialism, and they weren't looking to harass Christians or to bother Christians. In Poland, the Communist Party was very much afraid of the Catholic Church, which was the great institutional alternative to communism. And they actually were glad for Protestant activity because they viewed that as something that might weaken the strength of the Catholics. So there's no great risk trying to do some things for Jesus in Poland. And even in a place like the Soviet Union or Romania or Czechoslovakia, they weren't going to hurt you. You know, now they might hurt the people you're meeting with in secret. They were the ones taking the risk for going to a Bible study taught by an American. But probably the worst that was going to happen to that American is we were going to get thrown out of the country, declared persona non grata, not allowed back in. I was very, very blessed. Everything I did was easy. People with Campus Crusade or people with a ministry called BEE, Biblical Education by Extension, they'd do all the heavy lifting. They would make the contacts. They would gather the groups, and I would just come in and teach. So it was a thrilling privilege, one of the great privileges of my life, to be in those places during those times.
Wow.
We hold dear from Romania and have his books, and it's Richard Wurmbrandt.
Yes.
From there.
The Romanians, you know, when I say that every country is different, Eastern Europe is dominated by Slavs. You know, you've got the Czechs and the Poles, the Western Slavs, you've got the Serbs, the Croatians, the southern Slavs, but Hungarian is not Slavic, and Romania is not Slavic. They're actually Latin, descended from Roman soldiers and the Aboriginal people called the Dachas. And so they're always laughing. Their temperament is, you know, like South Americans or the Hispanic people. They're very, very different. And during those days, the Romanians really knew the scripture. They knew the scripture better than their cohorts in the other countries. They knew the scripture far better than I. And I would go in and train pastors, and I would think this is so ironic because they know the scripture so much better than I. They hadn't had the opportunity to theologize or systematize much of what they knew because there wasn't really any literature available in Romanian, and it was hard to get their hands on Christian literature in English, but they were so fervent, so full of the Holy Spirit, so full of truth and wisdom. And I remember being going up the stairs in the home of a wonderful Baptist leader in Bucharest, a former lawyer called Talos, a very cultured man, and I'd met with him many times at church, and this was the first time I was going to his home. And of course, the building was almost derelict and quite seedy, and we were walking up the stairs, and he turned to me, he said, "My country is not a poor country. My country has poor leadership." And I'll never forget that. Mm-hmm. And also, it was thrilling when the dictator was deposed. You know, he had banned, of course, Christmas carols, and the most well-known Romanian Christmas carol began with the words, "Ring the bells, the Christ child is born." And on Radio Bucharest on Christmas Day 1989, some of your listeners, and maybe you'll remember that Ceausescu and his wife Elena were executed on Christmas Day, And on that day, that Christmas carol was played for the first time in a generation on Radio Bucharest. And the announcer began by saying, "Ring the bells, the Antichrist is dead." And the great revolution that sparked freedom, which began in Timișoara, I met a Christian leader that I'd known in secret in Timișoara. I saw him in January, the very month after Ceausescu was deposed and executed. And he said, "Do you want to hear what a revolution sounds like?" And I said, "I'd love to." And so he got out his little cassette player, and you could hear 100,000 voices chanting. And I said, "What?" This man's name was Jalu. And I said, "What are they saying?" He said, "They're saying God is alive." So, it's the most thrilling thing you can imagine. Wow. I happened to be in Germany the day the Berlin Wall fell. And it was just, words can't describe it.
Yeah, I imagine those are some of the moments that just make the hairs on the back of your arm stand up.
Well, you're just be alive on those days and to see God work in history.
Yeah. You mentioned earlier on about the challenges your wife had with the Russian winters. What was the greatest challenges for you? I imagine for her it was the weather, the Russian winters, and for people saying that the winters can't be that bad. And we were in Siberia in the winter. And like you said, their winters do not play games. Maybe you can talk a bit about that. But yeah, what were some of the greatest challenges for you during those times?
Well, I think the greatest challenge was actually my wife's suffering. Because women make the great missionary sacrifices. Because men usually just do what they want and try to say it's God's will. And missions and foreign missions was actually great fun for me. I was never conscious of a sacrifice. There were slight sacrifices. In this sense, you're not there for birthdays. You're not there to be with your mom and dad at Thanksgiving or Christmas. Mm. And really, right now we have twin grandsons who are 2.5 and they live in California, and it's so hard for us. Until last week, I hadn't seen them in a year. It's so difficult not to hold those children. Well, you reap what you sow. And I took the grandchildren away from my parents and my wife's parents, not just to the West Coast, but across the ocean. And this is a kind of missionary sacrifice. Of course, it's nothing compared to the missionary sacrifices a couple of generations ago. As you know, missionaries would pack their belongings in a coffin. They would use the coffin as the trunk. And when they said goodbye to their mom and dad, what they were saying is, "You'll never see my face again. You'll never hear my voice again. And I will learn about your death, or you'll learn about my death, 2 years, 2 months or 3 months after it happens." And, Hudson Taylor wrote to his parents when he was about to embark for China, "How then will recompense his smile, the sufferings of this little while?" So, of course, the separation from people that you love, that's the hardest thing. But again, it's nothing. We have what we're doing now. We have Zoom calls, and we have FaceTime, and we have Skype, and we have jet travel. We were always able to come home frequently. Most of the time we were overseas, but there were frequent visits home, and there was visits from like our parents to us. So, it's hard to make that much of a missionary sacrifice as a Westerner, as a Western Christian in the 21st century. Now, of course, there are Christians in Afghanistan right now who are making supreme sacrifices, and in North Korea and in Iran. It's happening. It just doesn't happen that often or to that extreme with us coddled Westerners.
What would you say in such a time as this that we're living through now, where I wouldn't call it persecution, but opposition is certainly rising in the West? When you look at having spent time in the East and you look at what is starting to happen in the West, what would you say to the Western Church?
Well, I would say this. Check your motives and ask yourself what you're most afraid of. Are you afraid of losing your high standard of living? Or are you losing your freedom to worship God and to do what the scripture says? And I would say that the way we prove the sincerity, or I might even say the holiness or the justification of our fears, is showing that we know the right stewardship of property by not holding it with a closed fist, but by holding it with an open hand, that we're not meant to hoard. We're meant to share and to scatter. And we're meant to be a channel of God's physical blessing to poor people and disadvantaged people. That's to be our disposition toward our property. And in terms of our freedom as Christians, we need to make sure we're exercising those freedoms now and not just being glad that they're there hypothetically, even though we never practically deploy them. And by that, I mean, worship. You know, here in many of the finest churches around here, we've done surveys, and apparently committed Christians in truly biblical churches, they don't go to church over 2 times out of 3. Most of them, it's about 2 times out of 4. In other words, a couple of times in the month, but not every Sunday in the month. John Stuart Mill, one of the most famous agnostics of the Victorian era, he said he said 2 very convicting things. Number one, he said one reason he wasn't a Christian is because he'd never seen it attempted. He'd never seen Christianity attempted. The second thing he said is that Christianity never really caught on in England until its leaders contrived a way to reduce the commitment to 1 hour a week. Now, this is somebody teaching us from hell. You know, he went to hell. I think he died in 1873. But I'm convicted by that. I want to know why people go to hell in terms of their consciousness, if they have a conscious reason. I want to know why people reject the Christian faith. And I find his remarks pretty convicting. They convict me. So, I mean, maybe a time is coming when we can't share our faith. Are we sharing our faith now? You know, when's the last time we engaged an unbeliever and pressed gospel claims on it and asked for a decision? So when we look at I've also had some little experience in the Mideast. In my second incarnation as a missionary, I was able to visit Iraq 17 times. And I've also spent considerable time in Azerbaijan, where there's no great danger there. It's a Muslim country. There's no great danger there. And quite a bit of time in Turkey. So what's the worst case scenario? We have this leftward secular drift as our government becomes more and more anti-Christian. And, you know, we have some very ominous trends in terms of curtailing Christian expression. And so what's the worst case scenario? Well, I would say the worst case scenario would be persecution all the time. And execution some of the time. Well, if that happens, that's actually the first century scenario. That's what the first century Christians faced. They faced persecution all the time and execution some of the time. So what did they do? They won the West. The Roman emperor bowed the knee to Jesus within 300 years. In that context of persecution all the time and execution some of the time, the early Christians won the West, at least even in a superficial way. I'm not saying the West was, everybody was born again, but in the institutional sense, they conquered. So with all our freedom and with all our prosperity, what have we done? We've lost the West. So it's important to get a biblical perspective on what is happening, not just an economic perspective and not just a political perspective. The first time I ever heard Josh McDowell, who's one of our best living apologists, I heard him as a student. And the first time I ever heard him, he said, he was talking about the first time he went overseas. And he went to England with a university friend. And he said, I realize I'm talking to British people, but I'm going to tell you what he said. He said, I was amazed how poor England was. And I can remember on my first trips to England, for instance, tissue paper, which felt like wax paper to me, and small bathrooms, not very well ventilated, and no water fountains anywhere. And so I knew what he was talking about. But he said, then he realized England is not a poor country. England is one of the richest countries in the world. But America is super rich. We've been coddled. We have been protected. And we think this is the normal Christian life. Well, read the New Testament. You know, our life is very rarefied, protected. And, you know, we may get our chance to have a New Testament experience. Well, if we do, shout hallelujah. I mean, maybe we're going to slide into heaven unchallenged. Maybe when the martyrs ask us, well, how do you get here? We're going to say, well, I choked on a ham sandwich. And I don't guess there'll be embarrassment in heaven. I don't guess that's allowed, or it wouldn't be heaven. But golly, I'd be embarrassed if I could be embarrassed. You know, what? You never had a chance. You know that great poem by Amy Carmichael, "Hast thou no scar?" You know, do we bear no wounds because of our faithfulness to Christ? And I think, listen, I'm as committed to comfort and safety as any pagan. And I'll take comfort and safety if I can get it. But to choose that over obedience is a shameful thing. And it ought not to be. It ought not to be true of any believer.
Yeah, it's... Sometimes we will be in meetings, or I'll give an example. I was in a small group meeting one time, me and my younger sister, and the subject of persecution came up. This was in England. And this conversation went on for a while, and I know when certain subjects come up, it's sometimes best if I keep my mouth shut, and the subject of persecution is one of them. So I just sat there quietly listening to everyone, and you know, people talking about the temperature and the pressures rising in England and the fear that they don't want persecution to come and all that kind of stuff. Well, the leader of the small group turned to me, and he knew that I'd been in and around persecuted nations most of my life, and said, Andrew, do you have anything that you want to add to the conversation? And I said, well, to be honest with you, I think some persecution would do the church good in England. And the conversation, it all went very quiet, and people were quite uncomfortable that I'd said that, but recognizing that the church in England was going in such a direction that it needed a bit of a kick up the butt. And, you know, when we talk about these issues, though, it, It makes people very uncomfortable, the thought that they might have to go through suffering. And in America, if these subjects come up, we often hear people saying, well, look, we know these things are coming, the Bible talks about them, but we are some time away from that happening here in our country. We don't really need to worry about it too much. We did a podcast episode the other day, which we haven't released it yet, but you may have seen some of these clips going viral online of the pastors in Canada getting arrested. And there's one of a pastor and his wife and the children, and they're all crying outside the building as the police handcuff him, and the children are crying, they're praying with each other, and then they put him in the car and take him away. We interviewed him last week and talked about that and the pressures that they've got in Canada, and this is right on America's doorstep.
One of the phrases that he said is faithfulness is costly.
Yeah.
Faithfulness is costly. And we said to him, what would you say to people now? And he said, practice your faithfulness.
I think that we're actually already in judgment, even though we may not feel pinched or may not be conscious of suffering. I think that it's very, very likely that our children and grandchildren are going to be conscious of suffering and conscious of being in judgment. And we have to prepare them. We have to prepare. We have to show them what the experience of the Hebrew children was in Babylon. We have to show them what the experience of Joseph was. We have to show them what the experience of the apostles was, all of whom, of course, except for the Apostle John, were executed. And we have to tell them that this is what the Christian life leads to. You know, when the Lord Jesus recruits us, he puts all the hard things first, because he says, if you follow me, it's gonna mean a cross. Well, a cross is an instrument of torture. It's death by slow torture. And we know where the path to the cross leads. And we know what the final experience is. We study Matthew 24 with our prophetic charts. And, you know, we try to work out, well, are Christians going to go through the tribulation, or are they going to get out? What is the abomination of desolation anyway? What exactly is the budding of fig tree? And yet there's just a little phrase in Matthew 24 that we never talk about. And the phrase says, they will kill you. They will kill you. In John 16, 2, he says, you know, a time will come when people will kill you. And they think they're doing God a favor. They think they're serving God by killing you. Well, I mean, I think in context, that was the Jewish response to the gospel. But now, of course, it's the Muslim response to the gospel. That verse and prophecy is still very, very operative. So, yeah. But here's the thing. So let's say we opt out of the Christian life. And let's say we opt out of the Christian life because we want to avoid pain or we want to avoid difficulty. There's no guarantee that we're going to go through life without pain or difficulty. I mentioned the death of my father a moment ago. My father and Jim Elliot were born in the same 30-day period, not the same month, because Jim Elliot was born in January. My father was born in February, but in the same 30-day period. And my dad, as far as I know, even though I'm confident he was a believer, as far as I know, he never risked his safety for the sake of the gospel. Jim Elliot obviously did. Because my father, or at least maybe one of the reasons that my father never risked his safety for the sake of the gospel, he lived 38 years longer than Jim Elliot. And Jim Elliot was speared to death at age 29, and that was terrible. And I'm sure the last 30 seconds were horrific, absolutely terrifying and horrific. But you know what? Jim Elliot did all his dying in 30 seconds. In 30 seconds, it was over. It took my dad 4 years to die. He died of cancer of the bone, 4 years of agony. His last coma, he was in agony. We know it was a light coma because he cried out in pain. I don't think God was punishing my father. I don't think God was either punishing Jim Elliot with an early death or rewarding him with a quick death. You know, I don't think we can sort these things out. I don't think we have enough wisdom to sort them out. It's a dangerous thing to speculate. But I do know this. I do know that taking measures of self-protection guarantees nothing. It guarantees absolutely nothing. Suffering is the lot of us mortals. And some of us will die quickly and we'll be blessed because of that. The Puritans used to say sudden death, sudden glory. Some of us will die slowly and we'll see death as it approaches. There are advantages to that. We get to say goodbyes. We get to plan our memorial service. We get to set things in order. But it's a little bit scary to think of that great thing as it approaches. But we're in God's hands, regardless. And He's charted a path for us. And if it involves suffering, hallelujah. Unless we're alive when Jesus comes, please God, let it be. But unless we're alive when Jesus comes, we know the path involves death. But death is not a terminus for us. It's a point of transit. Mm-hmm. And it's quicker than minutes past.
You know, we have a few statements that have been our family's lifetime, really. One is light. We are called to be lights. Light was created for darkness. Where there is darkness, there is danger. So that's where you run. And so we have been in crazy situations because of that. The other thing is, we live to be martyrs. Martyrdom was normal in the Bible, so it's a normal thing. Either we die for Jesus or we live martyred lives for him on this earth. There are a few other mandates we have. But one of the things that I hear parents saying to their children, one thing that comes out their mouth probably every day are the words, be careful, be careful, be careful. The words be careful aren't anywhere in the scripture. I say to them, the Bible says be wise and be bold, but it don't go around saying be careful, be careful, be careful, like that's the mandate we have to live by.
Well, it does say be careful to do the things that I've told you to do, but not a careful thing.
Not in that context.
Yeah.
And it is our family, it has been in our family's DNA. Well, it's been in my DNA the whole of my life, and it's in my children's DNA that those are the principles we live by. And I think it's sad that we see the gospel through different eyes.
Well, I think those are very wise thoughts, and that those are very wise principles to live by. You know, when I think of this business of running toward the danger, we have to determine what our vocation is, what our calling is. Once we understand that, we will know the difference between fleeing and faithfulness. And there are times to flee. You know, Paul escaped Damascus by going over the wall in a basket under King Aretas. But there are also times when you face the danger. You know, he wanted to face the Ephesians mob. He wanted to face the Jerusalem mob. And he had to actually be restrained. And one of the most iconic photographs in American history, probably so far the most iconic photograph in this century, in America at least, well, there would be two, both related. One is the photograph of the second plane hitting the second tower on 9/11. But connected to that, there is a photograph at street level of people running hard away from the buildings. But you know, not everybody was running away. Some people were running in. And the people who were running in were people who wore the uniform. They had chosen a uniform of a policeman, of a fireman, of an emergency worker. And they were running in because their vocation was rescue. And you can't rescue people who are not being threatened. And you have to go near the threat and the danger if you're going to be an instrument of the rescue. And of course, rescue is another word for save. So once we know our vocation or our calling, we'll know where to be. And as I said a moment ago, we're going to die anyway. It's not like we're never going to die. And, you know, if we crash, let's crash trying to take off, not trying to land. And if we die, let's die trying to protect others from danger instead of trying to protect ourselves from danger, because we're going to die in any case. You know, it's not like we escape death. We can have an honorable death. We can have a shameful death. The choice is ours. It's easier to talk about that. It's easier to talk about that than it is to do it. I can remember once in communist days, in it was either Cluj or Arad, Romania, and the Securitate came to the door. And I was teaching pastors the Bible. And I remember my first thought was not something heroic. I was thinking, I wonder if I could fit under the bed. And the answer was no. You know, but that was my heroic thought. I hope I have room to hide in the bed, you know. So sometimes those dangerous situations show us who we really are. But we don't advertise ourselves as heroes, but hopefully we'll make the right choice, and it'll be a heroic choice, not a cowardly choice when the moment of testing comes.
It is encouraging for us, I know, to hear what you're saying, and I hope to many people listening it is. I think we have to get back to the reality of the gospel, to the reality of the word, and not just pick and choose what's in it. We quote, like you did, take up your cross, and it's not a pretty thing that goes around your neck. It is, and the people who heard it at that time would have known what it meant. And so I think, you know, hearing you speak, if we could just get back to the reality of the word, to the reality of the calling, going back to Richard Wurmbrand, he used to take, when people wanted to commit their lives to Christ, he would take them to the zoo, to the lion's den, and he would stand them in front of it and said, your father, the forefathers, had to contend with the lions. If you're willing to follow Christ, you make your commitment here as you look in this lion's den, knowing that that could be for you. And so it's facing people up with the reality of the gospel right from the start.
I think that one thing I would like to say to your listeners is that a plane ride never made a missionary, and a plane ride never made a martyr. And you don't have to, you know, I've been very, very privileged to work in about 50 different countries and to live in four different countries, three of them post-communist countries, and to visit Muslim countries. And that's not a usual experience for most Christians. I'd like to say that, in my opinion, the most heroic thing any Christian can do is to adopt a child. And the reason I say that is I've been in some mildly dangerous places, but you know what? I always knew where the airport was. And I always had an exit strategy. I always had a plan to get out of there. You know, if you adopt a child, there's no exit strategy. It's a lifelong commitment. And even though we trust the Lord with risk, it's the ultimate roll of the dice, because you don't know what kind of genetic deposit you're getting, because you take that risk if you have your own kids. But it's the ultimate lifelong commitment, and especially if you adopt a child with darker skin and you realize the social challenges, the personal heartbreak, the rejection, what that child is going to go through, what you're going to go through with that child. And I can't tell you how much I admire Christians who do that. I can't tell you how much I admire Christians who move into poor, dangerous communities to do incarnational ministry. and people who are drug dealers and people who are pimps and people who are gang members, some gang members who have a initiation requirement of shooting a white person. And yet we have Christians who are moving into those kinds of neighborhoods for the sake of witness and the sake of rehabilitation. I cannot tell you how much I admire those people. And what they're doing is 10 times harder than anything I've ever tried to do in a Muslim. I mean, I'm a religious tourist compared to those people. And I rise up and call them blessed, you know. And so you don't have to get on an airplane and go somewhere else. There's plenty to do within driving distance of where we all live.
Well, yeah, I think I will link in the description box another episode we released just a couple episodes ago with a lady called Ashley Feltz, who her and her husband, they're Christians. They've got, I think, 4 biological kids. And now they've adopted 2 children, one from the Philippines, one from China. And they're in the process of adopting the 3rd child, another one from China. Although that child has been taken by the Chinese government. They're trying to figure out where she's gone.
But one of the children's blind.
One of them's blind. The other one also has disabilities. And it's, like you said, beyond inspiring to hear the process they go through, the struggles, the things they do. I think the episode we did with her is called Adoption, Reflecting the Gospel, or something like that. And so I'll put that in the description box, and I recommend that after hearing this, people go and listen to that episode. And may some hearts be impacted so much so that they might do what you said and go and start exploring this journey of adoption, especially if people are listening and they're pro-life. We often say that it's one thing to be against something, but it's good to be pro something as well, to be for something. So you could be against abortion, for example, but be a champion of adoption. So I pray that people would be inspired to be able to take up that mantle and run with that, for sure.
She says adoption is the gospel lived out on earth. And that is it. I won't give away that, but it's just interesting.
You don't say too much. People won't go and listen to the episode.
No, they need to go and listen to Ashley, because it is profound. And we could now, I think, go down several avenues with you, opened up a whole new more. So maybe
we can save that for another episode.
Yes, we can have you back for another episode. And I'm thinking maybe the title for this should be, "It's Better to Crash Taking Off Than Landing."
I'm not sure that was an exact quote.
Isn't that what you said?
I said, if we're going to crash, let's crash while we're trying to take off, not while we're trying to land.
Yeah, I make a great title for this thing.
Ronnie, thank you so much for taking the time. We really appreciate you sharing some of your story, but also this has been a powerful part, the second half as well, of challenging people about, one, the times that we're living in, but also the challenge of, you know, what are the battles that you're taking up? What are you going to start running with? Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ronnie, so much.
Well, thank you for your kingdom labors and your great commitment to the gospel around the world. May the Lord grace all your endeavors with his blessing.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for listening to this episode. If it inspired you, please rate us and subscribe on Apple or Google Podcasts, Spotify, or another podcast platform.